from the pen of the Apostle Paul, a challenge to let our light shine in the darkest of times, realizing that in the midst of our weakness, His grace is sufficient. A letter to the saints in Corinth, defined by three words: trust, treasure, triumph. Welcome to our verse-by-verse study of 2 Corinthians as we learn to stand for truth while empowered by the grace of God.
We are in the series Trust, Treasure, Triumph. And that's the series we kind of default to when we're not doing the smaller three-part series. So we're kind of plugging them in between. We're doing a lot of these three-part series here in the winter and spring, and then we'll be more into the verse-by-verse of 2 Corinthians in the summer. But anyways, it's awesome to be back into the book of 2 Corinthians. It's a book that really contains a lot of information that helps us know how to live. And that's why one of the reasons we're here today is to find out from the Bible. We believe in the Bible. There's very few churches that really, truly do believe in the Bible anymore. We're one of just a few that we believe this is the Word of God. And this has the answer. The most important answer is, what about eternity? But it also has the answer about, what about today? How can I be a better dad, a better husband? How can I be a better employee or better friend, a better neighbor? See, God has the answers for all these things right here in the book. We just don't know it. We don't open it. We don't read it. So in this church, we believe it and we read it and we study it. We also, on Sunday nights, have another series that is going on. It's called Origins. We believe that Genesis is literal, that God created the heavens and the earth. He did it in six literal 24-hour days, and He rested on the seventh. We're going through those things, and if we understand the Bible, you say, well, what about all the scientists and all the professors that say it took millions and millions of years to get here? We're going to get into that real soon. It really, the answer that most people look at, the problem most people look at is geology and all the different layers, and the assumption is that it took millions and millions of years because things were then as they are today. But we know there was one huge event that the Bible describes that really helps us understand, really, geology, not uniformitarianism, which is all the stuff that we see in geology just took millions and millions of years to lay down. Actually, that doesn't make any sense. What makes sense is the flood of Noah that would explain the upheaval in geology that we see. So we're going to get to that today, though, tonight at 6. Some people think we just have the same service at 11 and at 6. We have totally different services. In Sunday nights, what we do, we have new music. It's a little bit more relaxed, and we have a little bit more fun. I'm not saying we're not having fun today, but it's just a little, it's kind of like family, you know, you kind of get together with family. And tonight we're going to discover a couple things. God naming the animals. Now that's pretty amazing that God gave Adam the job to name the animals. We're going to talk about that. I'm going to have a project for you kids. If you're a kid in here tonight, you have a job tonight. And you're going to help me come up with alternative animal names, okay? Maybe not giraffe. Maybe crazy spotted animal with long neck. I don't know. Whatever you want to call them. You'll help me with that. So we have an assignment for the kids. We also will learn more about original sin. What was the serpent? What did the serpent look like that deceived Eve? We're going to try to go into some of those things tonight and really try to understand those details. And then obviously we're going to talk about the forbidden fruit. And that's the sad part of the story of Genesis. The creation and all of that, and the first two chapters, and then it just like, bam, chapter 3, we blow it. So really, that's what we're doing tonight, and I think it'll be a wonderful study, especially kids seem to be enjoying. I'll have a lot of pictures, a lot of videos on the PowerPoint. So come back tonight at 6 if you normally don't do that, if you can. Some of you can't, I understand that, with jobs and all of that. But if you can, it's a wonderful time, and I hope that you will. My question to you today: are you ready for a one-on-one appointment with Jesus Christ? That's a huge question. Are you ready for this? You say, is there such a thing? Yes, there is. There is such a thing. The last time we were in this series, Truth, Treasure, Triumph, we talked about a new body. These designer clothes won't go out of style. And we're gonna have a new body, we're gonna be clothed with a new body, one that doesn't see corruption, one that doesn't have a sin nature, one that won't get cancer or get osteoporosis or get arthritis. A body that literally is redesigned to live forever and in the environment that God has for us. So many people think heaven is just kind of ethereal, floating around, a cloud, a harp. That's not at all what heaven's gonna be like. It's gonna be much like this, but so much better. And it's gonna be awesome. And God will give you a special body. If you know Jesus Christ the Savior, you will have that new body. We looked at this verse the last time we talked about 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. We are confident, and boy, we have some reasons to be confident in Christ as believers. We are confident, I say, willing rather to be absent from the body and present with the Lord. It's instantaneous. When a believer dies or a believer is raptured, which is an event coming in the future, there's an instantaneous aspect to it. We're literally absent from the body the very same nanosecond to follow. We are present with the Lord. That's why a Christian funeral doesn't have to be a funeral like the world's. Sure, there will be tears, but there won't be anguish and agony because we have confidence that we're going to see that person again. So whether we're absent from the body or present with the Lord, whatever the situation is, we long for that day, but there's so much more for God that he's going to do in us and through us here. Let's talk about this first event after the rapture. The rapture is the calling up of a group of people that will not face physical death. The Bible talks about it in a couple places, Thessalonians and Corinthians, and it alludes to it several other places. It's a real doctrine in the Bible, and it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful time. Dad has always said, I'm not looking for an undertaker, but an uppertaker. And that'll be great, won't it? To skip the funeral home and casket and embalming and all that other creepy stuff that happens in those places. Sorry if you're a funeral director, but somebody's got to do it. I'm just glad it's not me. Amen. Wow. But there's going to be that moment, that rapture, when the believers are caught up together in the clouds to be with the Lord forever. And immediately after that, in our eschatology, our understanding of end times, according to the Bible, is an event. There's an event. We find it in our text today. We call it the judgment seat of Christ, or the Greek word is bema. The judgment seat or the bema seat of Christ. So let's look at the first thing today, and that is to work or to labor in love. 2 Corinthians 5:9, wherefore we labor. Let me stop and talk about the word wherefore. One man once told me, hey, I love your sermons, but I'm not as excited when you get to the end and you start using the word therefore. Because the words wherefore and therefore are therefore a reason. Okay? Therefore and wherefore are basically, it's coming after a truth, and that truth demands action. So we're okay with speaking about truth. We're okay about, you know, talking about doctrine and truth. But now when the preacher starts calling for action, or the Holy Spirit starts convicting us to action, now we have a problem. Now we're forced to make a decision to obey God or not. In the Bible, doctrine is the why. But that's always followed by duty, and that's the how. This is what God wants us to do and how he wants us to do it. One person put it this way. He said, Christianity knows no truth which is not the child of love and the parent of duty. See, when we come to the word wherefore, we have to look up back a little bit and say, why is it there? What is it there? Wherefore, God moving from explanation to application, wherefore we labor. So the truth of all of this, the truth of the fact that we're going to receive a glorious body, there is a great and glorious future for us, therefore, or wherefore, we labor. We work. We strive. It says we labor. Paul was a man of ambition. You say, wait a second, I thought ambition was evil. Ambition is bad. No. Ambition can be selfish, but if it's a God-honoring ambition, it's a wonderful thing. Some of our graduates from our college are ambitious young people. And then they're on fire and they're excited and they see what can happen and they see what God can do and they're excited about it. And they go out there and man, they're like gangbusters. They're doing incredible things. And they see people getting saved and getting baptized and growth and money going to missions and all of these things are happening because they're ambitious. And there's others that graduate and they're not ambitious. They're kind of ho-hum Christians. You know, they're almost like some of the Calvinists. What will be, will be. If God wants this church to grow, he'll make it grow. And I know there's a component to that, and God is the one that gives the increase, but God also inspects us to be ambitious and hardworking for him. God wants you to be busy doing his work and bringing him glory. We can be busy with a lot of things. You can be busy with being lazy. I know a lot of people that are really, really busy with being lazy. Or you can be busy with work. You can be busy with a hobby. You can be busy with a sport. You can be busy with a lot of things, but God wants us to labor. Wherefore, understanding the future, the glorious future that we have, to work hard to serve him. You say, well, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a missionary. I'm not talking about pastors and missionaries only. I'm talking about any Christian, anyone that have put their faith in Christ. We are to labor. Wherefore, we labor. We should strive to please the Lord. It says in Romans 14, 18, for he that in these things serveth Christ, not just preachers and missionaries, but everybody, kids, adults, older, younger. He that in these things serveth Christ. What is serve? Well, serve is the person that is a servant. Serve means that you're looking out for the things of God. You're serving other people. He's gone. He's in heaven. He's coming back. But while he's gone, you are his feet. You are his hands. You are his mouth. You're to be serving other people. You're to be attentive. You're to be looking for things to do. And I see a servant attitude in this church. I love all of you getting so excited about how we can make things better. And so you've literally rolled out the red carpet. Those that have been given the assignment of making our nursery easy, accessible, and pleasant. Our nursery always has been great, but it's kind of hard to find. So you literally rolled out the red carpet. Makes us want to have children. So we can bring them to this nursery. Now, we do bring Willow to the nursery. And it's amazing. It's a servant heart, a servant attitude. And so many of the rest of you, there's people that are out there, rain or shine, cold or warm, parking people on Sundays. That's a servant's attitude. That's saying, I want people to have as easy a time possible getting in and out of here as we possibly can. You're serving Christ, and that is acceptable, Romans 14, 18, to God and approved of men. And then back in our text in 2 Corinthians 5, 9, it says, wherefore we labor that, whether present or absent. So now we're talking about whether we're present with the Lord or not present with the Lord. That's one of the two realities. You're physically present with the Lord or you're physically not present with the Lord. If we're present or absent, one or the other, in other words, now and or later, okay, we may be accepted of him. You say, wait a second. I thought if I put my trust in Jesus Christ, his blood pays for my sins. I am forgiven. I am literally a child of God. He can't lose me or forsake me. I thought I was already accepted, and you are. You are. You don't have to worry about entrance into heaven. This isn't talking about acceptance into heaven. This is talking about Christ accepting your service. Christ accepting the way you've lived from the moment of salvation on. It is important how we live, not to get saved or to prove that we're saved or to stay saved. It's important the way we live because we are saved. And there's going to be a day in which we will have a one-on-one appearance, our eyes gazing into the eyes of Jesus Christ, no one else around, you and him. And that we may be accepted, or that he might be pleased of us at that time. It's a thought, isn't it? To know that this is something that is going to come. You say, well, where does it say that? I'm glad you asked, because point two is the Bema Seat appearance. 2 Corinthians 5:10. For we must all. Who is the we? The we is those that have received Christ as Savior. The saved. Saved. Those that have put their faith in Jesus Christ. You're born again. Those that are born again, that's the we, must. This isn't a voluntary one-on-one with Jesus. This is an obligatory one-on-one with Jesus. If you're saved, you will be there at this Bema Seat. We'll say, if there's millions of Christians, how can we all be there, you know, all at the same time? I'm not sure how it all happens, but I know the Bible talks about we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. We have a lot of people that judge a lot of people. And by the way, there is place for judgment. Somebody says Christians are too judgmental, you shouldn't judge. And that's kind of true. In other words, there is a place for being judgmental. There has to be, okay? In the church, in Christianity, in the world, we have to be. Here's the problem with being judgmental, is when we are doing the same or worse ourselves. It's described as the person that has a speck in his eye and he's being criticized by the guy that has a beam in his eye. How absurd that would be, but that's how it often is when we judge. So judge not doesn't mean that you shouldn't ever judge. It just means you better really examine yourself first, okay? But there is a judgment coming by a perfect judge. There was once a judge who was always being criticized by an attorney. Man, that attorney would rip him up and down, which I would think would be a really bad idea if you're an attorney to criticize a judge. But it was happening. And at one event, there was a man that had been observing this, another attorney, and he went to the judge. He says, I'm kind of bothered by that this guy's always doing this and you're never really defending yourself. You're never really sticking up for yourself. Why don't you say something against that? And the judge looked at the man and said, well, I have a neighbor. He's got a dog. Every time there's a full moon, the dog barks all night long. The judge tells that to the attorney, turns away and begins another conversation. Well, the attorney said, well, after a few minutes, judge, I need a little more than that. And the judge turns back toward him and says, oh, I'm sorry. He says, okay, the dog barks all night at the moon, and the moon still shines. There's going to be barking dogs. It doesn't change anything. His point was this. When you're being criticized, it's probably a good idea to take a look at the criticism, but realize it might be unjust criticism. People are very prone to criticism. We like to say constructive criticism. Usually we're not trying to construct, we're trying to destruct when we criticize. We have to be very, very careful about criticism, about judging other people. Not to say we don't, and we shouldn't, because we should at times, but we'd have to really examine ourselves. But anytime anyone has said anything critical of me, the first reaction is, what an idiot. And I'm not referring to myself when I say that. But here's the deal. I better take a little look at my life and make sure I don't have at least maybe a part of what I'm being criticized for in my life. It's probably not a bad thing to hear that because it makes us stop and think about it and examine ourselves. And if it's not founded, or maybe there's a little truth to it, fix that and go on. Don't let that barking dog stop you. But there is a judgment that is coming, not to determine heaven or hell. That's been determined here by your faith in Christ. But to determine, you say, well, what's determined at this judgment seat of Christ? Okay, that it says back in 2 Corinthians 5:10 that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. So we're talking about Jesus Christ analyzing our life, judging our life to see what he will reward you for. The Bible talks a lot about rewards, about crowns. And there are some theologians, and I think this is true, that believe that your rewards will be a type of currency in heaven. I don't think that's far off. I think you will, if you serve the Lord, and by the way, it's not, some people think, well, if I could just get up and preach to millions of people on television, I'm gonna get some amazing rewards. That's not what, God judges not based on the scope of the number of people that you're ministered to. God judges your heart, your intent, your love for him. Your motivation is very, very important. Not necessarily the outcome, although that is important, but that's not the most important thing. The most important thing is that you love him and that you're committed to doing his work and to listen to his promptings, to the Spirit of God prompting in your life to tell you how to react, what to do, how to deal with this situation, how to encourage this person. All of those things will be laying up for yourselves treasures in heaven, rewards, and also positions of responsibility. The Bible talks, and Jesus talked about in parables, about some people being rewarded as the mayor of a few cities, some as the mayor of many cities. I really think that, and again, this, I'm speculating, but I'm probably not far off on this, that you will be rewarded, not only rewards, but also responsibility in heaven, eternity. So it's important how we live. It's important what comes out of this judgment seat of Christ. You say, well, what's the downside? Let's say I live for myself. I'm selfish. I'm not doing the things of God. I'm living a worldly life. What's the downside? The downside is that you won't get rewards. That's a big downside. The downside isn't just that you won't get rewards, but that you will, that he will be disappointed at how you've lived. And that's huge. We should think about that today. What matters is what Jesus thinks. That's all that really matters. So now is the time to prepare. Look at Romans 14:10. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Be so careful when you are judging other people. 1 John 2:28. Now, little children, abide in him. You say, how can I make sure my judgment seat experience is one not of embarrassment, but of reward? These three words right after it says, little children, abide in him. That's the key. That's the key to the Christian life. You say, how do I abide in him? Well, if you know Christ the Savior, you have the Spirit of God living in you, every morning what you need to do is say something like this, humbly say, Lord, I want to serve you today. I want to do your will today. I want to be what you want me to be today. That's abiding in him. That's you saying, I can't do this myself. I'm going to need your assistance. Not to say that you're going to be like a puppet, a marionette, But he's literally going to prompt you, and you're listening to him, you're abiding in him, you're attached directly to the vine, and you will produce fruit. But when we start moving away from him, when we stop reading what he has to say for us on a daily basis, when we stop communicating with him in prayer, we're not abiding in him anymore. Guess what? You're not going to produce fruit. You'll produce selfishness, but you won't produce rewards in heaven. Can you imagine how embarrassed people are going to be standing before the one who did everything, and they did very little in return? Is your head going to be high? Is your head going to be low at the judgment seat of Christ? Let me give you two scenarios, and I think all of us will understand these two scenarios. One is your boss is going to be gone for a week. He gives you a list of responsibility and some tasks. After he's gone, you have a choice. You can get right to it, work hard, be ambitious, and make sure that you do everything and more that he asked you to do so that when he returns, he is pleased with you. Or you can be lazy and selfish and put off those things that he gave you to do and do all the other things that you want to do, and then on the last day, you can try to kind of make up for it, and you're not going to. It's going to be one way or the other. Or you're a parent. Here's another scenario. You're a parent. Your kids are older. They're old enough to leave at home. You say, how old is old enough to leave at home? 30? 35? I don't know. No, I don't. You know, let's say your teenage kids, or a couple kids are going to be at home on a Saturday. You and your wife have to go out all day. You're going to come back. And you're good parents, and you give your kids jobs to do. You need to make sure your kids get some work experience, okay? They should be doing stuff, and you give them a list. These are things that need to be done today, and you leave. Your kids have two choices. They could turn on the TV, or they could get to it and do the work that you've asked them to do. And when you come home, you're going to be pleased if they've worked hard and they've done everything, they were careful, they were attentive, and they did everything that you asked them to do. You're going to be pleased with them. Or you're going to be frustrated and disappointed with them. I don't think either of those scenarios are too far off of what God is asking us. Jesus has left the earth. He has said, while I'm gone, here are some things I want you to be doing with your life. But there's going to be a day of reckoning, a day of recognition. And how will you be when you're one-on-one with Jesus? By the way, let me make sure everyone understands that we're not talking about a great white throne judgment. This is the Bema Seat judgment. I'm going to give you some verses in just a second in Revelation chapter 20. But the word Bema is an actual location in many Greek cities. It was a platform built up, and it was a place that they would deliver speeches. It was a place that they would hand down verdicts, or, and this is how I think it fits within our context, it was a place that a person would give out awards to those that won in the Olympic Games. In the original Greece Olympic Games, the Bema Seat, think about the modern Olympic Games, the award platform. You have third place, you have second place, it's a little higher, and then the middle is first place, okay? Think of that platform. This is the analogy that we're talking about. This is the Bema Seat. It's a place where rewards will be handed out for faithful service, or, you know, hard work, ambitious work for God, okay? Now, the judgment seat, the Bema Seat of Christ is for only believers. Then there's another judgment that's called the Great White Throne Judgment. It's in Revelation 20, verse 11. I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. So this is a terrible sight. This is a sight for the future, verse 14. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. This had better get your attention. You're going to be at one of these judgment seats. It's going to be the judgment seat of Christ because you put your faith and trust in him. Your judgment will not be based on your works for salvation or heaven or hell, but will be based on your acceptance of him as Savior, as he paid the price for your sins and he paid the penalty for your hell, and you will appear before him for a day of reckoning, for reward or loss of reward. Then you have the judgment, the great white throne judgment, which is a separate judgment around the same time, a little bit later than the Bema seat. And that is a place where all that appear before that seat are lost. You say, well, what's the purpose of that? They're not found in the Lamb's Book of Life. Therefore, they're cast into the eternal lake of fire. Their works will also be judged. And I believe they will be judged for a level of hell. You say, well, isn't hell hell? Hell is hell. Believe me. Hell is a horrible place. The Bible's very clear. Jesus is very clear that it's a real place. It really exists. And it's reserved for those that reject God's love. It's made for the devil. It's made for the demons. But it's also the destination of all who reject him, reject his love. And there will be degrees of hell. I think Hitler will have a worse hell that someone else might have. But it's all hell. It's all fire. It's all darkness. It's all isolation. It's not you and your buds drinking beers. That's not hell. That's might what your hope hell is like. But that's not going to be hell. It's not the cartoon. Okay? It is a serious, horrible, horrible thing. So which judgment will you be at? The one for the saved or the one for the lost? This judgment seat of Christ will be a place of revelation. You know, in this life, we can fool people, we can trick people, we could put on a facade, we could pretend, and most of the time, you can do a pretty good job at that, although the Bible's very clear, you know, what's done in a closet will be broadcast on the housetop. Everything will be revealed. But this is a place of revelation. You're not going to be able to fake and hide and pretend with Jesus. He's the perfect judge. He sees all things. He knows all things. There's no point in trying to pretend at this judgment seat of Christ. And it is a place of reckoning. Not only a place of revelation, but a place of reckoning, as we will have to give account to our life and to our ministry. Romans 14:12. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God. This is something that we need to be thinking about today. Why? Because we still have time today. Tomorrow may be too late. 1 Corinthians 3 in verse 12 gives us more detail about it. You can choose to build upon the foundation. The foundation is Christ. Gold, silver, precious stones. Or you can use combustible materials, which is a bad idea, wood, hay, and stubble. So what is the gold, silver, and precious stones? I think that's everything you do. You love the Lord. You want to serve him. And everything you do serving him, if it's cooking a meal for someone that's homeless, if it's literally taking in orphans, if it's making hospital visits and just helping people, encouraging people, whatever it is, those things motivated because of love are gold, silver, and precious stones. Giving someone else the news of the gospel. Gold, silver, precious stones. So what are these other things? The wood, hay, and stubble. Well, those are the things that you're doing that are motivated because you're selfish and because you just want to elevate yourself. So then when the gaze of Jesus Christ, just think about his gaze as a burning gaze. You ever had someone staring at you and they're literally like burning a hole through you? The gaze of Jesus is going to be literally gazing at you, and those things that are gold, silver, precious stone are going to survive. The things that are wood, hay, and stubble, guess what they're going to do? They're going to burn up. They're going to be gone. So it is so important that we are living our lives building up things that are gold, silver, and precious stones. In verse 13 of 1 Corinthians 3, every man's work shall be made manifest. It's going to be made obvious what your life is all about. For the day shall declare, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work. This is not the fire of hell. This is the fire of the gaze of Jesus. And if any man's work abide, which he hath built thereon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved. See, this is not a judgment of heaven or hell. This is a judgment of heaven. But you might be there by, yet so as by fire. In other words, by the skin of your teeth. You don't earn heaven. You're not there because of things you've done. You're there because of your faith in Jesus Christ. But you might be there with empty hands and empty pockets. This is a very serious thing we're talking about today. The third thing we'll talk about is motivated by respect. There's two things that should motivate us as Christians. In verse 11 of our text, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. The great white throne judgment is terrible. But there's also a healthy respect for the judgment that we're going to face as believers, the gaze of Christ. We should understand and have a fear and respect. You say, why? The Bible talks about love and the Bible talks about fear. How do you have those two things in balance? Well, it's not always easy, but I think we can look at the life of children. We can look at a good balance with kids. They should have a very healthy respect of you, but they should also have a real healthy love for you. And if we look at that, we can see how we should be with our Savior. We know the terror of the Lord. We should have that respect for him. We persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your conscience. For we commend not ourselves. Remember how they were accusing Paul of, they had all these letters of commendation and he didn't. And he's like, you know, it's not about commending ourselves, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance and not in heart. For whether we be beside ourselves, you know what that word beside ourselves means? Cuckoo. Okay? So if someone calls you crazy because you love the Lord and you serve the Lord and you're in church and you're crazy, why would you go in church when you could be doing other things like sleeping, you know? Okay, you're crazy. Whether you're beside yourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. So whatever they call you, do it for the glory of God. He was called crazy. Ignore that. Don't worry about it. If people think you're insane because you no longer are chasing the American dream, but you're now trying to please Christ, you're in good company because people said Jesus was crazy as well. Dwight Moody, a preacher here in the Chicago area many years ago, was a successful salesman, but he left that. He left that to start Sunday schools and to do ministry and to help kids and to help people. He was an evangelist, very popular evangelist. I was down doing some radio last week, and down at Moody at the radio area, radio station, they had a little museum down there. I went in there, and they called D.L. Moody Crazy Moody. Crazy Moody. How would you like that to be your nickname? But you know what? We don't know the names of the people that called him Crazy Moody anymore, do we? But we know the name of D.L. Moody. Motivated by the terror of the Lord, motivated by respecting the Lord, but also motivated by love, as we finish in verses 14 and 15. For the love of Christ constraineth us. That's what's pulling us. That's what's motivating us. Because we thus judge. Okay, now this is the bottom line here. Why should we serve the Lord? Why should we think about the judgment seat of Christ? That if one died for all, by the way, Jesus' death can pay for every person's sins, okay? They have to accept it, but it can. Then we're all dead, that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves. Now this is it. But unto him, why? Which died for them and rose again. How can you be saved? You believe in the one that died for you and arose again. You trust in him. Now, as a saved person, you pass from death to life when you believe in him. Now you live for him. Again, not to be saved, but to show the world that you're saved. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Psalm 2:11. Love in this verse, love here in our text verse, is agape. Remember agape? Agape love is sacrificial and selfless and unconditional. Okay? That's the love. That's the love we are to have for him. There's a lot of Christians that are selfish. It's like the little boy and girl that were sitting on the coin-operated merry-go-round at the store, and the little boy said, you know, if one of us could get off, there'd be more room for me. Don't live your life that way. Live your life for the one who died for you and rose again for you. And then he will make sure you live a life that is selfless. You have a one-on-one appointment. Love, respect, and serve the Lord every day, and you will please him, and you will be rewarded by him. Let me end with this story. This is it starts a little bit sad. There's a Christian junior high camp, and at the camp, one of the campers was a boy that had spastic paralysis. And unfortunately, he was the subject of ridicule by the other boys. When he would ask a question, the boys would deliberately answer in a halting, mimicking way, making fun of him. One night, his cabin decided to ask him to give the devotional to everybody. It was one more way that they could have some fun at his expense. Unashamedly, the boy stood up. And as he strained and slurred and spoke in a halting way, each word coming out with enormous effort, he said simply these words, "Jesus loves me, and I love Jesus." That's all he said. Well, it stunned the boys in that camp. Many of them realized how terrible they were. Many of them began to cry, and it is said that revival swept through the camp that year because of one boy and his handicap. But he had everything in his life because Jesus loved him and he loved Jesus. It's really that simple. If you want to have a heads up, not a heads down, one-on-one with Jesus, if you want to be confident at his appearing, realize that Jesus loves you and just love him back by loving other people. Today, I've explained the gospel throughout the message, and I'm going to bring that home to you. Have you put your trust, your faith, your dependence ever in Jesus? Have you said, well, my church can save me, my priest can save me, my pastor can save me, my prayers can save me? That's all wrong, because it's not by works. For by grace, it says, are ye saved through faith? How are we saved? By our works? By our faith, and not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. What's a gift? A gift is something you receive. It's free. So salvation is by faith, and it's a gift. It's not of works. No one will stand in heaven and say, I'm here because I deserve to be here. Everyone will stand in heaven and say, I'm here because I don't deserve to be here, but Jesus paid for my sin, and I accepted his gift. That's it. It's not about what you do. It's about your trust in him, the person, Jesus Christ. He died on a cross. He's the Son of God. He's perfect. He died in our place, his sacrifice, and he was put into the ground, and the ground couldn't hold him, for in 3 days he rose again. And anyone who puts their simple childlike faith in Jesus has, at that very moment, everlasting life. Now, as a result of our eternal life, we want to serve him, please him, glorify him with our lives, because there is a day when we will be standing before him one on one.